Nilkanth, I'll start actually by going back to a conversation we had in March when this whole sort of crisis came ashore. At that point of time, apart from the market and the liquidity issues, you said that one needs to judge the extent of the economic sacrifice needed to curtail the health crisis, and then who bears that sacrifice. As we come to the close of this year, are the answers to those a little clearer, both in terms of the GDP sacrifice and then how it's sort of being divided across various segments?
Excellent question. So, I think that is the biggest question. And why this matters is perhaps important to understand. So let me spend maybe half a minute, 1 minute on that. So if you look at FY22 over FY20, currently, published consensus at minus one. But I think if I see the updated consensus, meaning economists have started bumping up FY21 to about, not minus 9.5, but say minus 7.5. So we're at about plus 1%, right? And at the beginning of the year, FY22 was supposed to be 13% ahead of FY20. So if you're, you've gone down that low. Now, there's been 6 months of a lockdown. So if you just wipe that out, right? And assume that there was no growth in that period and you had just stopped people from working. So 6 out of 24 gone, 25% gone. So that 12 or 13, you went down to 9. So if there is no lasting damage, no scarring because of these 6 months of intense weakness in the economy, then FY22 should be 9% ahead of FY20. Right, hypothetically, we are at plus one. Right, so the question to ask, and which is why it's very important to understand what is the lasting damage to the economy, what has been the scarring from the pandemic. We had done this, what I was later told was a Caldorian analysis, that is the split of incomes into government, corporates, and households. And this was when the consensus number was minus 10% for FY21. So we found that about 20 trillion rupees of GDP loss. What was interesting to us was that nearly 75% of that was what we called water under the bridge. Right? That people didn't earn, didn't consume, forget about it. Right? So the lasting implications of that were very low. As that minus 20 has become minus 15, I think the impact on the lasting impact on the economy, in my view, is far, far lower than what we had thought even at that time. Right, because a couple of things have happened. The first is that the companies have managed to shed costs very sharply. So generally, when this happens, you either destroy the company's balance sheet or you destroy the household balance sheet. Right. So basically, they take on more debt or shed assets and all that. And what we found was that because the companies had been shedding costs so aggressively, and very interestingly, when I asked my colleagues to do a bottom-up survey and they talked to companies in the June quarter, that companies had cut fixed costs very sharply. How much of these fixed cost cuts will be retained? I was shocked. Only 7% of the fixed cost cuts were to be retained. So my question was, how are these fixed costs? These are all variable costs, right? But the heads under which these costs were classified were all fixed costs. And what that suggested to me is that the firms have, by and large, used might and scale, especially the larger ones. And they have managed to push down the pain too. And they have retained growth capital, right? So that's the first thing, that the risk capital loss has not been anywhere close to what I had feared at that time. Because when you stop the clock, so I had written this thought piece in one of the papers where I said, can we stop the clock? How is it different from everyone going on vacation and coming back, right? And the problem was that you could not stop the salary clock, you could not stop the interest clock, you could not stop the rent clock. And the evidence of the last 7 months, 8 months, suggests that to a large extent, the Indian economy has actually brought that down. So the pain has gone down to the bottom 30-40% of the enterprises and the individuals. From an economic perspective, while that is, I think, from an inequality perspective, that's a disastrous outcome. From an economic momentum perspective, that is actually the best possible outcome. Because, and I'm not recommending, I'm just commenting on what has happened, that the top 10% of the Indian economy consume more than the bottom 50%. And I'm not talking about incomes or savings, I'm talking about consumption. So the top 10-20% have come out of the pandemic, of the lockdowns, with a better balance sheet than earlier because their consumption was more impacted than their incomes. It is the bottom 50% whose income has been more impacted than their consumption, because consumption, they do nothing discretionary, right? I mean, they almost everything is basic. So their balance sheets are much worse. But as we have come out and the savings, the incremental savings that the rich had is being sort of deployed with a vengeance. The economy, that is the economic stimulus that has come through, right? That those savings are being deployed. And therefore, the lasting damage from the economy is a lot lower. In our estimate, the about 50 to 60%, maybe 55-60% of the losses are being borne by the government. Right? The government debt to GDP has gone up. So that is the ultimate water under the bridge, right? That you sort of socialize all the losses. I would say that about 4 to 5 trillion rupees, so out of 15 trillion, about 8 trillion is the increase in government indebtedness. About, I would say, 4.5 trillion is the loss of personal income, right? The drop in wages. But that is offset by the drop in consumption, didn't earn, didn't consume, right? So water under the bridge. And it's the poor who are left with a worse balance sheet and the rich with a better balance sheet. There is about 2 trillion rupees or so, which is the loss of retained capital, retained earnings for companies. But they too have also not done investment. So basically those retained earnings generally go into capex, right? So they've not been investing, right? So GFCF has been down. So the lasting damage from this pandemic is actually a lot lower than I had feared in March. And it is partly because it has been so short-lived. And also because the big animals in the jungle have managed to muscle their way to the water bodies, and the smaller animals have been left aside. But now they are, I think, likely to drive growth. So economic growth perspective, I'm not that worried.
As things stand right now, where are we at in this cycle? So we did not see a huge amount of government spending. We are seeing that starting to pick up, perhaps. We are seeing easier financial conditions. And we are starting to see some of that consumption come back. Is that where we are at right now in the economy?
Yeah. So again, very important to think about where we are. So I think the recovery from the pandemic is mostly done, meaning a very small part of the economy. Mostly, unfortunately, schools are shut, right? Otherwise, I think most of the rest of the economy is back. But I think there are several elements that still need to be, where the momentum is still upward. The first is that FY20 also, if you remember, was not a normal year, right? So towards the end, of course, there was a big problem. But even during the year, there was a lot of destocking. So our thesis has been that there was a divergence between services GDP growth and industrial GDP growth. And that, in our view, was evidence that the industrial output was being hurt. So now, if the end demand is growing at 3%, but everyone in the supply chain is destocking, the perceived demand for manufacturers is down 3% or 4%. And that is what was showing up in GDP. The very fact that the destocking is over means that this plus 3, even if it's a plus 2, this minus 3, minus 4 has to go to plus 2. And that cycle is still on, right? And I don't think this gets over in 2-3 months. So that's the second thing. The element of the fiscal impact, India's fiscal policy, I think by accident, has been actually quite pro-cyclical. So in the September quarter, government spending, GFC, was actually down nearly 20%. And it actually took off 3.1% from GDP growth. If government spending had been flat, GFC had been flat year on year, we would have seen second quarter at minus 4.4%. And now, and part of this was because government taxes were weak. Part of it was the government also couldn't execute, because there's a lot of government functions which you can't do from work from home, right? So as both have normalized or starting to normalize, I think, and then government tax revenues are actually going up very nicely. So I think that in the second half, the numbers are going to improve. If you see the evidence of that, like, you know, the part of the fourth package that Atmanirbhar, that fiscal package that came out, the largest component was the fertilizer subsidies, right? 65,000 crores, out of which 48 to 50,000 crores was just clearance of subsidy arrears, right? The government just, something that had been pending for 6 years was cleaned up. Now, why would a government do that? the government would do that because they found that, my God, more money is coming in and we don't know how to spend it. Because it's not clear that, you know, it is going to result in some great transfer to a transition to DBT or something. I mean, not with this kind of a farmer protest, etc., going on. So I think that the fiscal situation of the government, normalization of that itself is a sign that there could be a further boost to growth, at least in the near term. And thirdly, you must have seen that export numbers have gone down, right? The growth of non-oil, non-gold exports has actually had gone to plus 5%, it's gone to zero in November. And as with the IP and demand, et cetera, and the US, Europe lockdowns, et cetera. So I think by Feb, March, I think those will also start to recover. So I think the near-term momentum is actually much better than, or it can last longer than what currently markets are anchored.